Well, thank you everyone for being here today. For those watching online, thank you for joining us. We had some issues with the live stream, but thank God for the technology that you can be part of the service as well. Thank you as well. So for the friends and family that have gathered here, thank you for joining us. We ask that you put your cell phone just on silence during the service. Let me open in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we bless you, we praise you, we thank you for the privilege we have to gather together. We thank you for the technology that people can be part of the service, whether they're here in person or they're in another country. So we just thank you, Lord, for your hand upon every life. We thank you for the family. We thank you for the friends that have been gathered here. And we just pray blessings on this service as we remember Oswald, his life. And we thank you for all you did in and through his life. Help us, O God, to celebrate the life that you have given. And we just pray blessings on everything that we do, that you, O God, will be glorified. So we commit this service into your hands. Lead, guide, and direct each and every one. We pray for the spirit of peace. We pray for your strength and your joy to move through the ones that are going to be speaking. So we bless you, we praise you, and we just commit everything into your hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time we will sing, if you can join us. We will be singing the song that says, "We will talk it over in the sweet by and by." Just wait for the music.
Oh, shadows weigh them on my welcome. My Lord and I.
Thank you. You may be seated. At this time, we will have a scripture reading by Mrs. Ivy Smith. And then following that, we'll have the grandchildren to come, and they can just say, if they want to say something, they can come and speak. So we'll invite the grandchildren to come up after Mrs. Smith. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. May God bless you. I'll be reading from 1 Corinthians 15, verses 50 to the end. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption, neither incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. Ye shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is in the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. God bless you.
At this time, I'll invite the great grandchildren to come to the mic, and if they have anything they want to say about their grandfather, how much he loved them, and how much the relationship that they have, please come.
Grandpa, I love you more than you will ever know. Your spirit will forever be with your grandchildren. Thank you for the life lessons you have taught us. Your legacy will forever be within us. You are the strongest and loving man that I have ever known. From I was 7 years old, you have told me that I'm the most smartest kid you know. You saved me in many ways, and I'm so thankful. You made a garden, and the garden is your grandkids. Thank you for teaching me to be strong and to never give up. Grandpa, I just want you to know that we will carry on your legacy to show your children, our grandchildren, your grandchildren, the same love you gave us. We are your garden, and I know you will be within us every step of the way. I love you beyond words. Remember the times you worked at the bakery and will surprise us with baked goods. From all your grandchildren, until we meet again, we love you, Pops.
Thank you.
This is actually a speech written by Chantel. For unforeseen circumstances, she couldn't make it today. My grandpa, Pops, as you call him, was the best grandfather any one of us could ask for. He was my grandpa, but aside from my Uncle Colin, he was one of the first male figures in my life I grew to really look up to. He was our candy man, always gave us money anytime he came over, and at times protected us. I still remember Grandpa walking in our townhouse backyard in his signature jeans, bow legs, and baseball cap as I ran to the backyard door to greet him. Anytime he came to the house, he always had something, whether it was candy or even vegetables from the farm. He never came empty-handed. One of the fondest memories was when my older brother and I were fighting in the kitchen over something stupid. He ran over to part us. As my older brother walked away, he quickly gave me $5 and said, "Na mine, hush," and laughed at how I looked at my older, how I took on my older brother. I loved to see him when he came over, but I also hated it because I knew the television would be taken over by him watching his baseball all evening. He would say, "Chantel, go in the fridge and get my drink." And I would say, "Grandpa, you have to share, you have to share." I would go into the fridge and grab his brown bottle of juice, hoping to get some, and he would yell, "No!" Now that I'm older, that brown bottle of juice was his favorite Labatt beer. I used to believe my grandpa was rich because of the big car he drove, which felt like a limousine when he drove my brothers and me in it. My grandpa exudes strength, patience, kindness, love. He also cooked the best fried dumpling and kidney with little cabbage, just saying. As my grandfather lay in the hospital bed in his final hours, I was reminded how short life is. Our families are not perfect. No family is. Our parents are not perfect. But I can only imagine what it was like to work in those cane fields in Jamaica in the hot sun and in factories while still providing. Grandpa, I only have great memories of you. You reassured my brothers and me once when we were, you rescued my brother and me once when we were locked in our apartment at Willow Ridge, and I still talk about that heroic moment to this day. The man who seemed so strong and so rich to me lay in the hospital bed looking weak and helpless like a child, and I just cried. Not because I was hurt, but because I felt I was losing a sort of father figure. I could ask Grandpa anything, and he was always there when he needed to be, picking us up from daycare and staying with us when my mom worked late. The first man to show me how to cook, bake, and the little lessons in his stories he would tell us. As my grandpa lay there, I was reminded that one day we will all grow old, and this one day would be my parent, your parents, us. So I asked the question, what kind of story do you want people to say about your life? Were you kind? Were you loving? Were you patient? What mark did you leave in this world? What will your children say about you one day? Grandpa, thank you for treating me. Thank you for teaching me that parents are not perfect, families are not perfect, and we didn't choose our families, but we make our own choices. We choose to love, to forgive. We choose to learn from our mistakes, stay stagnant, or move forward. We can choose to put aside differences and not repeat generational cycles. Grandpa, thank you for laying the foundation for your grandchildren. You left a mark in my life that can never be erased. And for that, I say rest easy. I love you, and remember, death leaves a heartache no one can heal, but love leaves a memory no one can steal.
Wonderful. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Ryan, and on behalf of my family, mother, Chevette, and everyone here present today, I would like to briefly talk about how Grandpa impacted my life and the life of those around me. So given the circumstances that occurred later on in his life, which was glaucoma, he still found a way to make every situation imperishable and exciting. For example, he'd always turn every harsh situation upside down and turn it into a memorable experience that we will remember basically for the rest of our lives. I remember back in the day, I used to hate math. I hated doing my times table. But every time Grandpa was around, he'd always kind of like make it into melodic tone, like twinkle, 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 little star. And that way I would remember it. Anyways, unfortunately, my sister, Shauna, was not able to make it due to an incident she had with the airline. But I'm sure if she was here, she'd have nothing but positive things to say about him. Once again, on behalf of all of us, we love you and you'll be missed, Grandpa. We love you.
Thank you.
Hi, everybody. My name is Corey. I'm not good at public speaking, so I'm kind of nervous. I don't have a speech or anything. But I remember Grandpa for a few things. One is baseball. He taught me the game of baseball. He taught me the rules. He taught me how to play it. And I just used to sit and watch him, and that's one of my favorite sports to this day. Another thing he taught me was how to ride the train, the subway train. He used to take me downtown. He loved to go to Chinatown and shop and get seafood because it was on sale or anything like that. And he would just, all these little random stories he would tell me, I'd never forget. Like the sun moves every second. So like, you know, it's constantly moving. And he was the first person to show me that. And I just miss him, man. Like during the last few years of his life, I didn't have much of a relationship with him, but I just want him to know that I always appreciate him, even from giving a handful of us change, you know, to everything. And I miss him. I love him. Thank you.
Thank you, Corey. At this time, we will have a song by at this time we'll have a song by Carol Austin.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
My sincere condolences to all the family and friends that are gathered here to mourn Oswald Black, affectionately called Pops, and Uncle Ozzy. I was relating to my cousin Joan the other day. The first introduction to Uncle Ozzy, as I call him, was a picture that was sent to Jamaica, and I was talking to with my mom, Angie, and I can't remember if it was sent to my mom or if it was sent to Aunt Yvonne, but I know Aunt Liz sent it to one of them. And the first introduction, the first time I ever met or saw Uncle Ozzy was on that picture. And he and my aunt, she was in a pink outfit and he was in a nice suit. They looked like they were going to a funeral, wedding or something. And I just remember him looking so strong and handsome and my aunt looking, you know, so regal. That's the word I would use for both of them. And when I came to Canada, I've never met him a lot of times, but that picture was embedded in my memory of him. And so Uncle Ozzy, rest and sleep in peace. And I'm gonna sing this song, The Goodness of God. My mom loves that song and you can join me in singing it as well. And after that song, I'll sing the chorus of Oh, What a Sunrise, because God has been so good to us, amen?
Amen.
And even in the midst of us mourning Uncle Ozzy, he has and is good to us. And so if you can relate to that, and after, when our time has come, we can sing, Oh, What a Sunrise. So you can sing with me if you know the song, or just hum it. I love you, Lord, because your mercy never fails me. All my life, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. For all my life, God has been faithful. 'Cause all my life, God has been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. Hallelujah. It has led me through the fire in darkest night. You've been closer like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Sing it with me. 'Cause all my life, God has been faithful. 'Cause all my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. One more time. 'Cause all my life, God has been faithful. Has he been faithful to you? All our lives, God has been so, so good. With every breath that we are able, we will sing of the goodness of God. His goodness is running after, he's running after me. His goodness is running after, he's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. 'Cause all my life God has been faithful. All my life, God has been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yes, I will sing of the goodness of God. And when our time is come and we are depart from this earth, we'll sing. Oh, what a sunrise it's going to be. Death will lose its sting and the grave its victory. The silence will be broken and the storm clouds roll away. I hear the saints of heaven singing on our homecoming day. Oh, what a sunrise it's going to be. When death will lose its and the grave its victory, the silence will be broken and the storm clouds roll away. I hear the saints of heaven singing on our homecoming day. Heaven singing on our homecoming day. Sleep in peace, Uncle Ozzy. Yeah. Sleep in peace. God bless you.
God bless you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. It's wonderful. At this time, we're going to have a poem by Joan Lee Moody.
Tribute is on behalf of my sister Pat and I. Pat is in Jamaica. I wanted to first, before I read this poem, talk a little bit about Pops. For the first 32 years of my life, this is the only father I knew. So biologically, thank you, he's, someone would say he's not my dad, but in every way, he's been my dad. He met my mother with my mother having Pat and I, and you know, you hear strange stories about stepfathers, but that's not the case for us. And I'll tell you, I'll put it in just one, give you one example of the kind of man he was to us. I was about maybe 7 years old and living in the country at my grandparents, and he was married to my mom and living in Vier. Those of you that know Jamaica knows that's in Clarendon. And I went in the woods to get some firewood. And if you know Clarendon, you know there's a lot of large rocks, and my feet slipped in one of the holes in the rocks and scraped the skin off. And within a few days, it was infected really badly to the point I could hardly walk. So they sent me to where Mom and Pops was living. And this moment stands out more than anything else that I can remember about him. Every morning, for about a week, maybe 10 days, he put me on that bicycle and would ride me before going to work to Lionel Town Hospitals for injections It took a while for that wound to heal. And I still have this large scar on there, but every time I look at that scar, I remember Pops riding me on that bike to get injections every morning before going to work. And the Bible tells us we are to give honor to whom honor is due. I have to honor him because he didn't have to, but he did. A lot of men would have said, in plain English, enough me pitney on my responsibility, but not him. When it came to us moving to Canada in the 70s and he was working for a company called Comagro, and they would have a yearly family picnic. Colin, Wayne, you guys remember all that. And he never introduced us as his stepdaughters. He never treated us any differently. We were just his kids. You don't find that. You don't see that much. Again, he didn't have to, but he did. And you have to give honor to where honor is due. I look at life differently. Every accomplishment that we have achieved as adults, Our parents deserve a lot, and the loved ones, our parents, those that have supported us, our aunts, our uncles, our cousins that have supported us along that journey, deserves a lot of that credit. And we can't forget those. As my mom used to say, don't eat and wipe your mouth on the ground. In other words, remember those that have helped you along that journey. I cannot forget being ridden on that bicycle to get injection from a man that was not even my biological father, but stepped to the plate and was an awesome father. When it came to helping me with my kids when I was trying to get ahead in life and dropping them off at daycare and picking them up, he was there with my brother Colin, always helping to fill the gap. I can't forget those along the journey that have helped me. So my success is their success. So I really honor him today for stepping up to the plate and fill in the gap of a father for most of my life. I might as well say all my life, because I've never excluded him. I've always let him know how much I appreciated this. So this poem titled, My Journey Just Begun. Don't think of me as gone away. My journey's just begun. Life holds so many facets. This earth is but one. Just think of me as resting for the sorrows and the tears in a place of warmth from, sorry, let me backtrack. Just think of me as resting from the sorrows and the tears in a place of warmth and comfort where there are no days and years. Think of how I must be wishing that you could know today how nothing but your sadness can really go away, and think of me as living in the hearts of those I touched. For nothing loved is ever lost, and I know I was loved so much, and Pops was loved by all his children and grandchildren for those that he touched. God bless you all. Thank you.
My name is Martel. I'm Aswal Nebi. For the last, I can't write nothing because 60 years would mean too much to ever write or talk about. But that man is lying there. I think he's one of the most greatest men in the world. He gave away everything he had. Never stop giving. Never stop loving. Like I said, it would be so hard to talk about from the 50s till now. He passing away now, he leave the mantle to me. I'm mixing life for a whole generation. Sorry, man, but it's hard. Very hard. We go back so much. We share so much memory over the last 60 years. Maybe you guys in here wouldn't really understand. I'm saying to kids and grandkids, love your mom now. The kids them have the memory to live off. I hope all of you got a lot of things saved that you can live off. Memories, never you forget. See, it's my mom right here. It's 3 years now. Sister passed away 3 years now, but she's my mom, and she's right here. I don't take it off. Never. You know, my mom was so close, you know, grandpa and grandma. And he would always come home every summer from the cane field in Clarendon, coming to farm work in America and back to Jamaica. I remember 1959 when they bring the first radio back to Jamaica, a big battery and a string tall in the treetop to listen to Louise and Ronnie Shaw. You know, so much memories. He's gone. I just hope I make it long enough to see all of you, our grandkids, grow up. And you guys are going to have to pick up the torch when I go. I don't know how much more I have. I'm 78 years old now, so I don't know how much more I'm going to go. But I hope everybody be good. And then all them younger kids, stay with the trouble. Stay away from the law. Think twice. Bite your lips. Take a deep breath before you do something. Just one deep breath means a lot. And I would advise all the younger kids and grandkids, and great-grandkids coming up, this man never have a problem with the law ever since I know him. Never, ever. And I hope you all will follow his footsteps. Stay out of trouble. And try and maintain all the memories. Keep all you can, all the photos, something. Picture, put it in the car, put it in the visor, put it somewhere. so you all can see him and remember him. Never you let go and think of the good old days. So I'll have to say, farewell, Pops, phone class. Guess your sister will see you now. In your life, I hope. We all have to hold on to something and believe into something. So I hope Grandma and Grandpa will be happy to see your spirit. It will be too much for me to say, so I'll just let the service go on so we can get over here.
Thank you so much. Thank you. At this time, we'll have the eulogy by Wayne and Colin.
I gotta keep the glasses on. Try to keep this really, really, really light. All right. So last night I Googled the life expectancy of Canadian men, 75 years. Jamaican men, 74 years. On Pops' 90th birthday, I asked him, I said, Pops, what's the secret? Colin, no fast food. No eat too much when you eat. And I said, Pops, that can't be it. There's got to be more. So I'm going to go down Pops' diet. So you guys know exactly who he was. Breakfast, warm milk, 2 shots of rum. And 2 boiled eggs every day, no joke. Lunch, canned sardine on a piece of bread, black coffee, no cream, no sugar. Dinner, and as Chantel talked about, 2 beer, Labatt's Blue, preferably, a bowl of soup, or 2. And every once in a while, he would substitute that bowl of soup for fried dumpling, which he called Jack. And when Pops fried dumpling, the Jacks were about this big. It would take him 2 hours, but when he was done, you would need no meat, nothing else. It was just so good. You know, the only time I ever saw my father eat anything besides his regular meals were on moving day. He would buy us KFC. For the most part, give me 1 second here, sorry. For the most part, Pops lived a simple life. 19 years, worked at the same job, drove the same car. Do you guys remember that blue 1973 Chevy Impala? To him, it was the best car in the world, despite the problems. Jamaican born, and made sure everybody knew about it. Colin, everything good come from Jamaica, you know? I said, Pops, really? Everything good? And those aren't my words, those were his words. So Pops, how about coffee? Colin, Blue Mountain coffee are the best coffee in the world. Pops, how about Ray and Nephew rum? Pops, Colin, Ray and Nephew rum is the best rum in the world. I went to visit Pops on his 90th birthday. I brought him a slice of cake and a beer. And Pops looked at me and says, "Colin, what kind of beer you bring me? You bring me Red Stripe?" I said, "No, Pops, I brought you a bottle of Labatt's Blue." On January the 4th, 5:56 a.m., on January the 4th, 5:56 a.m., I received a phone call. The laughter. The laughter, the joy that he brought, the jokes to my life. The stories will come to an end. Here lies the man who shaped my life, who's the reason why I never settle. No one will outwork me because of this man. I try to emulate him with everything I do, how hard I work, how much I love family. So Bob, rest in peace.
Said my dad was very, like, something special to all of us. From the age of 13, he had me working. I can remember that, just to instill good values in me. Had me working night shifts in grade 7 at the age of 13. And I remember driving home with him a lot of times, like, "Pops, like, you have me constantly working." He's always telling me, like, "Work, just work. You're gonna grow and be a hard worker." And today, I am, like, almost anybody that knows me, my few will tell you, I'm a workaholic. Got that from my father. Right? Very loving person, very kind. Qualities that too amazing to speak of. He's just, gosh. You can tell by my brother, like, right? I can recall him coming to school one time when my clothes were stolen, and I called him and I said, "Somebody stole my clothes." It was the middle of winter. I said, "I need some clothes." And he was at work. He packed up a work uniform and brought it to school so I could wear it home. My friends seen it and they're like, "Yo, that looks nice," right? So the next week I had to get some uniforms for my friend, right? A lot of my friends would work at his workplace in the summer. And he was very community, very loving, strong man with impeccable qualities, right? And like my brother said, we try to emulate, especially his work ethic. Like, he's a workhorse, worked one place for how much years? 19 years straight, being a supervisor. He retired, right? Retired there. Very loving man, and we're gonna miss him a lot. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We've heard so much about the life of Oswald. Oh, he loved his family, he cared for people. He loved his friends, and the thing that he's always giving, he's always sharing his life. You know, it was once said that life is not measured by the breath that we take, but it's measured by the moments that takes our breath away. So much of Oswald's life we have heard today that just take your breath away because of who he is, who the person is. You see, when we live our life with people, with the people that we're connected with, the people that have impact on our life, They can either leave for us an inheritance or they leave a legacy. An inheritance is something that you get, but a legacy is something that is a seed that is planted in your life. That is something that you will always remember. So much of Oswald's life is about legacy. So much of his life is about what he was able to give. And the thing is that you can't give what you don't have. And it's and as we heard, in his giving, it is coming from inside of him. That's who he is. And today we're here as we think about his life. The thing is that we can't speak to him right now. But life as the death as a way of teaching us how to live. So use his example. Yes, we leave inheritance, but important thing, leave a legacy for the people that you're connected with. That's how you will be remembered. That is what will last for a lifetime. The legacy that we have is the one that Jesus left for us. He left that legacy for us so that we can live today. And not just for today, but for the rest of our life. Death as a way of tearing our heart apart. And many times in relationship, because of love, the only way we can express that love is through tears. Sometimes it's tears of joy, sometimes it's tears of sadness. But it's like a wound. It hurts before it gets better. So in the midst of your grief, in the midst of what you're going through, if you have to cry, cry. No one can grieve for you. Grief is a journey. It's a journey that we take. And it's your journey. So don't let anything rob you of that journey. And no one can tell you how long you grieve for. Because it's your journey. And in life that we live today, when we lose our loved one, it hurts. There is that pain. And when we look at this world today, all the world offers us is questions. But God is the one who has all the answers that we need. All the answers that we need for questions is found in his son, Jesus Christ. And that is something that we will get through a relationship with him. And as parents, as families that are here, you know, we offer that comfort that we receive, because the comfort is not for us, it's for us to share. A mother was walking with her daughter, and you know how kids are, small kids. She decided that she found out that she has 2 feet. She decided to run away from her mom. Running away, she fell. And as she fell, the mom ran towards her, picked her up. She realized that she had bruises all over her knees. She looked at her mom and she said, "I wish the world was a big cushion. So that, you know, when I fell, I wouldn't receive the bruises that I have." And sometimes in life, you know, we wish the world was that cushion for us. When the difficult times in life come, when the things that we have to go through. But let me encourage all of the children that are here, grandchildren, nephews, brothers, friends, those that are watching online, that is part of Oswald's family. Remember the legacy that he has left behind. And remember that the only place that you get comfort is through our Savior Jesus Christ, because he is the God of comfort. In Psalms 147, in verse 3, he says, he heals the brokenhearted and bandages their wounds. Can you imagine you're going through a difficult time, and this is the promise that we have, that God himself, he will heal your broken heart. All of the wounds, all of the scars of life, he will make sure it's well bandaged. In 2 Corinthians chapter, and this is my passage for today, 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, he said, praise be to the God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the God of comfort, the God who comforts us in all our troubles, not some of our trouble, in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those around us with the comfort we receive. You see, we understand that there is no comfort outside of the promise of God, or God himself. We try to find comfort in other things, but it's just temporary. Because he's telling us today that he is the source of comfort. And I don't know about you, if I'm looking for comfort, I'm not going to find comfort in something that's not the source. I want the source of comfort. I don't want a comfort to be handed. I want the source of comfort, so I will go to the source. And we understand that in this time of comfort, that not only that he comforts us in some of our troubles, but he comforts us in all our circumstances, everything that comes to us in life. He brings comfort. He comforts us in all of our comfort, in all of his comfort. And in Psalms 86 and verse 15, you know, we say that, but you, O Lord, you are a God of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and filled with unfailing love and faithfulness. He is a rock for us in our difficult times because his love is unfailing. We heard the song just a while ago from Carol. All my life you have been faithful. When you look back at your life, the people that God brings in your life, Oswald, for example, he brings people in our life so that we can receive his faithfulness, we can receive his love through his hands, through the people that we connect with. So this is why even this morning, if we look back at our life, we look back at the journey, the difficult times, the good times, the not so difficult times. But we can say, well, God, all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so good to me. So what can I do? All my breath, every breath that I have, because it was given to me by you. It is your breath in me. All my life, so I will live in the goodness of God. Is that where you want to live today? You see, the thing is that when we look at ourselves, because of the life that we are in today, the world we are in today, there is good and there is bad. There is evil. There is no perfect family. So stop going around looking for perfection in people. Because before we try to look for perfection, be perfect yourself. There is no perfect person. The only perfect person that walked this earth is Jesus Christ. And that perfect relationship that he had with his Father. So because we're not perfect, we need to realize that because I'm not perfect, I'm not going to expect perfection from people, but I'm going to love people. When I don't understand it, I give it to God. I say, God, I don't understand this, but I'm going to trust you. You have a reason why you brought this person in my life. The psalmist David said in Psalms 139 and verse 16, all my days, not some of my days, but all my days ordained for me was written in your book before one of them came to be. Nothing happens to us by accident. The rain falls on the just and on the unjust. Not because I believe I am good, not because I'm walking with God, not because I believe that, you know, I have so much. It means that when it rains, I won't get wet. But you know the good thing? I know who holds the key to my life. And I know that even in the difficult days, the difficult times, I can put my trust in a love that is unfailing. A God who is solid, the source of comfort, the source of the one who will comfort me through all the trials of life. In Psalms 85, he said, no good thing, absolutely no good thing will I withhold from them that walk in my ways. Even when I don't understand it, even when it doesn't look good for me, he's saying, no good thing will I withhold from you. And if I have that promise that he will not withhold nothing good from me, does it mean that I'm going to walk on the roses? No, it doesn't mean that. But what it means is that when I'm going through the difficulty, he is there with me. That's why the psalmist David said, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because the Lord is with me. The psalmist David in Psalm 61, he said, hear my cry, O God, and attend unto my prayers. From the ends of the earth will I cry unto thee when my heart is overwhelmed. Lord, when I don't know what to do, when I don't understand it, I don't know where to go, I don't know how to make the next step, lead me to the rock, which is much, much higher than high, the rock which is Christ Jesus. That's how you get your comfort. That's how you receive the things that you can go on in life. And he's not asking you to make leaps. He's not asking you to make long steps. One step. One step at a time. With him holding you. With him guiding you and protecting you through the course of life. Every day we get up, Lord, I thank you for today. Today is not promised to anyone. None of us know that if we will see tomorrow. But we treat every day, we treat relationships that God has placed in our life as something, as a gift for God. And sometimes, some of us, we need sandpaper. Some of us need that relationship to stir us. To help us to grow. Because he said, all my days ordained for me was written in your book before one of them came to be. And in Isaiah chapter 29, verse 11, he said, I know the thoughts and the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. They are good and not for evil, to give you a hope and to give you a future. God, I don't understand what my next day will be. I don't understand what my future is without Oswald in my life. But God has a plan for you. His thoughts towards you are good, not for evil. And his plan is to give you a hope and give you a solid foundation for the next day. So let me encourage you today. As you remember the good times with Oswald, what he has done in your life, just remember that it's through God's goodness in his life why he was able to share the goodness of God with you. And that's why it says that he will comfort us in all our troubles so that we can comfort others with the same comfort we receive. You see, comfort is not for us. Oswald was a conduit of God's comfort. He was a conduit of God's gift to us. So it is for each and every one of us. All we are is a conduit of God's love. Don't believe that everything you have in life is for you. When you do that, you become a reservoir. And nothing lives in a reservoir. When it goes in a reservoir, it dies. So we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. And the works that we do is how we live with each other, how we share our life with each other, how we share our comfort with each other. Because it is when we give, that's the time we receive. And we can't outgive God. We can't outgive his comfort. Because it is when we begin to comfort the people around us, that is when we are comforted. So let me encourage you today as we think. Our thoughts goes towards Oswald's life, what he meant to us, the thing that he has done in our life. Use those examples to be not just an inheritance, but a legacy for somebody's life. Let that be a seed. The seed that he planted in your life be that seed that germinates and go into another person's life so that it will bear fruit, and fruit that will remain. So when we think of all of this, it's evolved through a relationship with our God through his son, Jesus Christ. And when we have that relationship, when the things of life that could disturb you come, and you get upset with somebody because of something they say or something they do, just remember, you're just a breath. That breath can be taken. So what do? We go to God. God, I don't understand why this happened. So God, first, forgive me. Because we are not perfect. Because we are not perfect, God, forgive me. Even if I did something or I say something I am not aware of, please forgive me. And then we receive God's comfort. We receive his forgiveness. Don't just say, forgive me, and walk away. I receive your forgiveness. And because I receive your forgiveness can flow through me to the people around me. Help me to live a life that pleases you. And when we live in that state, we understand that you're not responsible for someone. You're responsible for your own soul. You're responsible for the ones that God has brought in your life, your children. But after a time, they will have to make their own decision. We all make our own decisions in life. But the decision that will last for a lifetime is the decision, a godly decision, a decision to give Jesus our life, give him our heart. So, you know, because of this world we're living in, sin has come. The Bible tells us when Adam sinned, all men became sinners. And in Romans chapter 3 and verse 23, it said, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Romans 6 and verse 23, it said, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is a life through Jesus Christ and an everlasting life. But God did something so that we can have a relationship with him and be brought back into relationship. He said, while we were in sin, Christ died for us, so that we can have a relationship with him. But before, with that relationship, we have to do something to say that if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart, we shall be saved. So in closing, I'm going to invite each and everyone that's here today for a dedication of their life to Jesus Christ. And if you're watching online, I encourage you to do so as well. So with your heads bowed, and you can repeat after me, Lord Jesus, I can't hear you. Lord Jesus, I thank you for saving me. I give you my life. I give you my heart. I give everything to you. You are Lord of my life. Thank you for saving me. Amen. That's it. Jesus is Lord of your life. And when Jesus is Lord of your life, he has everything. He has your back. When you're going through the difficulties, when the situation comes and you can't make the next step, he will take you and he will carry you to the next phase of life. We will sing the last song here. I'll Fly Away. Some bright morning in the life is over, I'll fly away to build a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I fly away. When the shadows die, the realm of Christ is gone, I'll fly away. Like a bird from their prison wall, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Happy when we meet, I'll fly away. No more cold iron shackles on my feet, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just one more. I'll fly away. Hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. I'll fly away. Hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Just a few more weary days and then
I'll fly away
to a land where joys will never end.
I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. Fly away. Hallelujah. Let me pray. Our Father, we bless you, we praise you, we thank you. We thank you for the life of Oswald. We thank you for each and every person that's here, those that are watching online. We thank you for their life as well. So Lord, as we go to the next phase of this service, we just pray for your protection, we pray for your love, we pray for your guidance. We pray for we thank you for who you are in our lives. And for those that are watching online, Lord, we thank you for their life as well. We thank you for everyone that has prayed that prayer for the first time today. So Lord, we commit this time into your hands. We bless you, we praise you, and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, I'll invite the funeral directors to come and give us the instructions from here. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. This concludes the service for Mr. Black. On behalf of the family, I'd like to thank you for your support and attendance here today, and thank you to those who joined us online. As we depart, we'll be heading to Glenview Memorial Gardens. The route that we'll be taking is making a right onto Derry, a right onto Airport, a right onto Steeles, a left onto Highway 50, and a right into the cemetery. We are in the Garden of Remembrance. For those of you traveling in procession with us, please obey all traffic laws and drive with your 4-way flashers on. And for anyone going ahead of the funeral fleet, please leave the way to the grave clear for the funeral and family vehicles. I'll kindly ask those of you acting as pallbearers to meet us by the main doors for further instructions. And the family has offered a token of their appreciation with a hot takeaway meal, so please take one on your way out before you head to your vehicles. In a moment, I'll ask Pastor Reed to lead us out, followed by the casket and family and friends following in behind. On behalf of myself, Jade Hibbert, and the New Haven family, thank you for allowing us to serve you. If you are able, please rise.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Just want to make it to heaven. I just want to make it in. Just wanna cross the river. I wanna be free from sin.